Okay, lecture four, I start chapter three, in fact, and 3.1, random variables, and these are like central in all probability, so we will be discussing random variables from now on. So what is, let's go back some recall function, f, from some domain to some range. This is always, I haven't said anything else, but this is sometimes called range, and sometimes called codomain, and so on. So, depends on the situation, I'm not sure what this one calls that. But anyway, so, in Venn diagram, I can write it, I can show it like this. So I have a function f, and this function is well defined because it takes x to a unique fx. Okay, so x goes to a unique fx. So, and this means goes to a unique fx. Okay, so we say that it is well defined because x does not go to two fx's. X goes to just one element in B. So that's a function. Remember from, I don't know, college algebra or something. That's in fact, remember that the horizontal line test, in fact it was vertical line test. So anyway, so a function should be well defined, which means x goes to a unique fx. But it's okay if two x's go to the same, say x1 also goes here. Okay. So x1 also might go here. That's okay. So if two of them go to fx, then it is still okay. Now, let's define something else. So let me erase all these things because this one is crucial. So A and B and the function f. What is f inverse? Well, usually in college algebra, when we start talking about inverse of a function, we speak about something that we call one-to-one or one-to-oneness of the function. So we say that the function should be one-to-one in order to have an inverse. But this notation is also used for something else, which is related to that, in fact. But it's also related to, I mean, it's defined this way. So let's take some subset of this, say u. So I want to see what f inverse of u is defined. So this is in fact all x's in A such that f of x belongs to u. Okay? So, pre-image, okay, we call it pre-image. So, what is it? It's like this. It's like going back. It's like going this way. Okay, not like going this way and see where this comes from. Like it's ancestor, or it's like a parent, say. Sometimes they call it parent. So, what are the parents of this subset U? Or any element in subset U. So, well, every element here comes from something here, right? So there's an X that goes here, but there might be more than one. So if I go back, if I move it here, then I will get things like this. I might have three, for example. Then these three are, in fact, they map here. So you can see that this, let's call this V1, this one V2, and V3. Okay. So in this situation, in this example, F inverse of U is in fact V1 union V2 union V3. Okay, so those are in fact the subsets of the domain that are mapped onto this subset of codomain or range B. Let me give you a simple example from college algebra. So, let's take the simplest function f of x equals x squared, and the graph of this function is like this. And let's take 4 to 9. So this is the u. Okay, so what is f inverse of 4 comma 9? This is the set U. Okay, horizontal lines can give me a picture of that. So what is this point? 2 and 3, negative 2 and negative 3, right? So f inverse is in fact negative 3, negative 2, union with 2 comma 3. Okay? So f inverse of that subset of, so you see this is the, this is in fact, what did I have? It was A to B, or say this is the domain, say, and this is the range. So the function is in fact from R to R, and R stands for real numbers. Okay, so the domain is all real numbers, but the range is not. In fact, the one, this, it's from 0 to infinity. That sometimes is called image rather than range, but that's okay. So f inverse of this subset of the range is the union of these two subsets. It's interesting that these are always mutually exclusive. And why? Think why these two should be disjoint. In fact, let me give you a hint. If they are not, then f is not a function. If they are not, f cannot be a function. But anyway, so that is a nice and simple example of what this means. You can think of, for example, let's say if the function is say, sine x, for example, then you can talk about f inverse of certain subset of the range of a sine, which is from negative 1 to 1. Okay. Now, let's see what a random variable is. So, a random variable let's take the sample space, that SP sample space, so S is a sample space. So S is my sample space, and random variable is a function. Usually we call it, we denote random variables with capital letters, so like X, Y, Z, and this goes to R. So technically speaking, a random variable is a function from sample space to R. So a random variable is a function from sample space into R. But this is real random variable because it is into R real numbers. Such that what? So this such that, I don't have space here, let me write it here, such that this is important, otherwise just a function from sample space to real numbers, so what? Such that X inverse of a subset of R, special subset in fact, but let's not talk about that special subset, is an event in S. Okay, such that it is an event in S. Remember, what was event? Event was our choice, right? So when we are given a sample space, we can define events. Remember, when the sample space is something like rolling two dice, for example, I can talk about event of getting a sum of four, okay? And I can just stop there. In fact, I cannot really stop there, but let's say I'm just stubborn and say, no, I don't want any other events, that's it. So this is crucial because when X, and we find X inverse of certain subsets of, in fact, any subset, you can talk about any subset of R, is an event here. But most importantly, it is a certain subset, but we will discuss that later. So it means that when I find X inverse, well, with X inverse, I take some U here, and with X inverse, I go back to here, then X inverse of U, which is something here, this X inverse of U, this is in fact an event. So it has been chosen to be an event. Otherwise, if for some certain subset of R, X inverse of that is not an event, then that is not a random variable. That's just a function. Okay, so that is just a function. Okay, so why do we need this thing? Why? Because we want to define like probability of something. It has to do with probability, otherwise random variable is what? You might have heard that, the probability of certain random variables, blah, 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 blah. So it has to do with probability, and probability was defined on events. Remember that P, that was a function, it was a set function, it was defined for events, not just any subset of sample space. It was defined for events in the sample space. So if I do not really, if certain subset of S is not an event for me, then a probability is not defined for that. And if X inverse of U happens to be that subset, then X is not a random variable. So let me erase this and tell you what happens now So this is x, and let's say this is r, and this is a subset, say u in r, and this goes into this x inverse of u, okay? That is x inverse. X inverse takes this, and I'm not saying it is in one piece. It can be several pieces. I just draw one in one piece. It doesn't mean it's one piece. It can be just several pieces. Then from here, the subsets, I have another function defined p of probability. So probability is applied to events. So we can talk about probability of x. Well, before I do this, let me give you a notation. Notation used in probability notation, important notation here. This x inverse of u is denoted by this funny notation. And we say that x belonging to u, x belonging to u. But in fact, what we're talking about is this event. So this is an event. This notation, like this is an event. You might say gx is a function belonging to u. It's a notation. Okay, so don't argue, please. Now we can talk about probability of this happening, probability of x belonging to u, and this is in fact probability of this x inverse of u. Since this is an event, this is an event, probability is defined on events, so that makes sense. Okay. Now let me give you an example, and let me just come up with something on the fly. Okay, let's suppose we roll two dice and we say we're gambling, okay? So let's say, in fact, most of probability was developed for gamblers, okay? Except for Bayes. Bayes was interested in proving something. He was a Reverend Thomas Bayes, so he was trying to prove something regarding the divine. Whatever. The rest of that was devised mostly by gamblers. Okay, so let's gamble here. Let's say, okay, if you roll an even number, an even sum, and get say $5. Roll an odd sum and pay $5. Okay, well, that's funny, but so it's a simple game. So what is the sample space here? The sample space for rolling two dice, our sample space is in fact S. is A and B such that A and B are both numbers between 1 and 6, right? And again, I emphasize that when I say rolling two dice, I mean rolling two dice with different colors, okay? So that is my sample space. So my sample space is ordered perhaps like this. So I might have 1, 1, I might have 2, 5, I might have say 6, 2, and so on. Da, 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 da. And there are 36 elements here. Then I define X into R and X of a sum of an even sum, X of even sum is 5. And X of odd sum is -5. Okay, so X of even sum is 5 and X of an odd sum is -5. So let's see, let's just write down some of so what is X of 1, 1? That's an even sum is 5. X of 2, 5, -5, right? And so on. So that's the random variable. Now why is it the random variable? Well, let's see. R, let's take R and let's find X inverse of subsets of R, okay? Now, if I look at R, let me erase these two and draw a picture of R. So this is 0, 5, -5, okay? So if my U is here, if U is here, U1, let's say, what is X inverse of U1? Empty. Right? And remember, I'm assuming that any subset here is an event. Okay? I'm not distinguishing between, I'm not saying part of them. Okay. So let's assume that any subset of the sample space is an event. So, X inverse of this is empty. Empty set is subset of anything. So this is a subset of S, so it is an event. This is good. This one is good. Now let's say that the U 2, U 2 is another subset, and U 2 includes 5. So what is X inverse of U2, which includes 5? Okay, I know that is in fact everything which with the sum being even. So it is AB such that A plus B is even. That is a subset of this, and I said I did not distinguish between subsets, and every subset of S is an event. So this is an event. Check it. What if I have something here? U3. X inverse U3 is all A and B, such that A plus B is all. Okay, that is also a subset. Should I check any other subset of R? This subset doesn't include this or this. And I got empty set. This subset includes U2. I got this one. This subset includes -5. I got this one, and they're all. Now, what if I take a subset that includes both 5 and -5? So any subset that includes 5 and negative 5, so let u, say 4, include both 5 and negative 5, then what happens? Then x inverse of u4 is s itself, right? And here, either goes to 5 or negative 5, and this u4 includes both of them. So it can be like a subset like this, or it can be the union of these two, right? This one and this one. Okay, so is there any other option? The whole R is also includes negative 5 and 5, so that's also something like u4. So I have checked every subset of the domain, and x inverse of any subset of the domain or any union of the subset is in fact an event. Yeah. Okay, so let's see. Now let's talk about probability. What is the probability that my x belongs to 5? What is the x inverse of 5? Just 5 as a subset here. 5 as a set that includes one element as a subset. So that is a, b, such that a plus b is even. Right? So what is the probability of x belonging to 5? That is the probability of getting an even sum. Getting an even sum. Okay. What is the probability of getting an even sum? How many of them will give me an even sum? So what are even sums? Let's look at the sums. We have 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12. Even, 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 and even. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 here. And 1, 2, 3, 4, is it 5? And 5 for R. So how many do you think will give me an even number? Starting with 1. So let's count. I'm not saying it is impossible to do that, but let's count. Or we can use counting principles, right? Maybe we can do that. So even numbers 2. Let's take 2 first. 2. How can I split 2 into two numbers? 1 plus 1. That is simply this one. For 2, it is simply 1, 1. 4. How can I split that into two positive numbers? 1, 3. 2, 2, 3, 1. Right? 1, 3. 2, 2, 3, 1. Well, there's a formula. In fact, I will post that for you. Those accounting principles. As part of the accounting principle, I discussed this today. So, how about 6? So that is the number that's 6 minus 1. In 2, that's 1 2 minus 1. So that is 5. 1, which is 5. Okay, so it's interesting. Then, 8 is in fact 8 minus 1, 1, 2 minus 1, that is 7. And then 12, no, 2, 6, 8, and 10. That is 10 minus 1. 10. It's restricted. Sorry, yeah, that, I cannot use that. They are restricted. They're not just any number. So, because I cannot write 8, 1, and 7. No, that's also wrong. Up to here is okay. Up to here is okay. Because 3 plus 3, okay. But let's say 8. I cannot have 7 plus 1, right? I cannot have 7 plus 1, sorry. So I cannot have 7 plus 1. So 8 will be 1, there is no 1, 7. So it is 2, 6, 3, 5, 4, 4, and 5, 3, 6, 2. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So that's also 5. Okay, so 5 and 10 will be 2, 3, plus 7, 4, 6, 5, 5, 6, 4, that is 3. And 12 is simply 66. So how many do I get? 1 here, 1 here, 3 here, 5 here, another 5, another 3, another 1. So that's 10, 16, 18. Well, you guessed. So that's 18, right? And even the odd ones are also 18 because we have just 10 and 6. So that is 18. We could have said that it's 18, you know. No, at least we did something. So P of getting an even sum. So there are 18 cases out of 10 and 6. One half. So P of x belonging to 5 is 1/2. And we can easily, this means P of rolling and even sum, right? This translates into P of probability of rolling and even sum. So what is probability of rolling an odd sum? That is x belonging to negative 5, and that is also 1/2. It should be because there's nothing else. So that is, now you might say, what is P of x belonging to U1? 0, right? So P of x belonging to U1 is 0. I can write it here. P of x belonging to U1 is 0. This U1. This U1. Okay. So that is some, say, discussion on random variables and how they work. Let me see if there is the book starts with Bernoulli and then continues, and I guess I can stop here as the second lecture. I gave you enough insight into random variables, although I used some concepts from algebra that you haven't seen before, or not like this at least. Okay, so let me stop. And I will continue next time. Okay, see you tomorrow.